today with and that is Stephen Wilmarth. Steve and I actually saw each other recently at MIT at their media literacy conference. What was that, maybe 3 weeks ago or so? And he said, oh, I was told I need to speak with you. And I said, oh, well, I already know you, Steve. We met in Vermont 2 years prior at an Action Coalition of Media Educators conference. We had a wonderful opportunity to hear Steve speak then. So I thought it would be great to ask him to come speak here and present all of the wealth of knowledge that he has. Steve is the director of the Center for 21st Century Skills in Connecticut. And what they work on in terms of their strategic plan is program development, professional development, and leadership development. And I will let Steve talk a little bit more about what they're doing in terms of incorporating technology into educational environments. So thank you so very much for being with us here.
Thank you, Julie. I think it's fair to say that we come at this subject with the same fundamental belief system that I think that what we're experiencing as educators is a real transformation in the way our students are coming to us, beginning to come to us, and will increasingly come to us in an age where, as the topic points out, you know, tech-savvy students, and I'm going to define what I mean by tech-savvy, because there's all kinds of potholes that one can stumble into by, you know, using such a general term like tech savvy and having everybody sort of buy into this, the same concept. But, you know, tech savvy, let's just for the moment take a leap of faith, suspend disbelief, and talk about tech savvy students stuck in tech-dominated schools. So, because again, what we're seeing is an increasing number of students that are coming to us who require a different form of engagement in order to fully and completely make the experience of learning a rich enough one where they look at learning not as a step in the process, but as the process itself. In other words, I think fundamentally what we need to be able to do as educators is stimulate students to adopt learning as a lifelong activity, and that learning is more than the kind of stuff they take away from a particular classroom experience, that it goes back to that concept of relationship. The conversation for educators, I get into this all the time in various groups, committees that are studying high school redesign and reform, curriculum design for the 21st century, that sort of thing. And, you know, there's always this conversation about integrating technology into the curriculum. And I guess I'm pretty hard about this. It's over. There's no more conversation about integrating technology into the curriculum. It's over. The digital natives, those people who are coming to us in the earliest grades, all the way through those who are now entering college, have never known life without the internet, if you think about it. They can, you know, they've never known life without the internet. And so the idea that, you know, curriculum needs to be force-fit or technology needs to be force-fit into the curriculum is a wasted conversation, because it's totally disconnected from the reality that students are experiencing in the world. The reality, that their reality is that everything they do is somehow or another connected to the internet. And there are lots of examples and devices that can demonstrate that. My first message to administrators is, get over it. Let's see if we make this run. This is sort of a, that's right, this is a PDF, it's not going to be video. In my regular presentation, this would have run and there would have been a server there, and that's those of us who are educators riding the wave, and it's getting bigger and bigger behind us. The question is, will we shoot the pipe or will we get wiped out? And the technology wave, the wave of digital natives coming at us is a pretty powerful one. That we need to deal with if we're going to keep the system functioning as it was intended to function, or discard it altogether, which is another possibility, another option. I don't know why educators, educational leadership, and political leadership for that matter, believes that education itself is somehow immune to the laws of economics in the 21st century. And even the laws of economics are having to adapt to the digital age, which is an age of abundance of knowledge. Abundance of knowledge, not scarcity. So even the laws of economics are looking at different ways of thinking things. We as educators, we tend to think of education as a walled garden. We like things organized and neat. You know, messiness is not a virtue in the classroom. But our whole testing regimen, our whole attempt to try to get students to receive knowledge, it's this received authority that we're still stuck with, that's several centuries old as a model for learning. That says that to the extent we can lock that outside world out of the classroom, that we can lock it out of our schools, keep it at bay, that learning will occur at a better, more robust level than if we let it in. Unfortunately, our science informs us differently. The cognitive science that we now is pretty clear, the evidence is pretty clear, is that learning does not happen at an even rate, that learning happens in many different modes, that those modes are being enhanced, those modes of learning are being enhanced by the kinds of inputs that students and the people are receiving all the time, it's really, the metaphor is not the walled garden, but probably a forest or a jungle. And you can look down the path and think you see the exit to that forest, you know, where learning is going to take you. But that's awfully hard to predict because learning has many side paths, branches. It can take you anywhere. There are fierce beasts in the forest, so you never know what's going to hit you or when it's going to hit you. We need to think of learning as start thinking of ambiguity as a virtue, as the idea that there's no certainty, there's no certain answers, that kind of certainty is not going to carry us to solving some of the biggest problems facing the next generation. You're not going to solve global warming, you know, genetic engineering, stem cell research, all of the big issues that face the next generation by thinking that, you know, everything is certain and immutable as laws of nature or as laws as laws of the land. So we need to change our thinking. And what we think of, we don't appreciate where we are in this continuum of history sometimes. We lose sight of it. The fact is that Netscape, which is the first really popular browser, it was Mosaic before that, but it was still pretty geeky, that Netscape is, as a public company, was only launched about 10 years ago. They just recently celebrated their 10th anniversary of the Netscape, the launch of Netscape as a public company, which sort of got everybody thinking, wow, what is this internet thing? It even got Microsoft's attention at that point. So it's only about 10 years old, and Web 1.0, which was that first sort of 7 years, we can argue that, you know, certainly blogs were written back in the late 90s, but the truth is that blogging as an experience, it's one of those curves that starts up very slowly and then begins to take off, and that the thousands of new blogs that are launched every day now are a more recent phenomenon, 2 or 3 years old. In fact, in education circles, the idea of using blogs and podcasts and videocasts in the classroom are really still being talked about as strategies that we need to use to improve the quality and the engagement of teaching. So, you know, Web 1.0, there it is. It's, you know, the first generation of the web. It's very static. It's read-only, you know, static web pages. Anybody who is familiar with the Wayback Machine, you can go back and look at web pages for Amazon and for some of the other popular sites, eBay, at their very beginning, and you'll see very simple, very, you know, unintuitive looking websites, and wonder how they ever got to be a buzz in the industry. But the next generation, Web 2.0, was what we're talking about in terms of this ability to both read and write, to respond without being a programmer, to be able to have an open web page that allows us to comment on a blog post, to send a letter to the editor, to communicate with, you know, the traditional news media, or to communicate within these social networks that we're communicating with. So Web 2.0 is a more dynamic read-write. It's still a very new phenomenon. It's still very recent. Now, I maintain that the internet revolution hasn't really come yet, because what comes next? And when will it come? Well, pretty, if you just use the literature, New York Times, I think this is November 12, 2006, a year ago, talking about Web 3.0. What is it? What's Web 3.0? Well, there are things now that we're talking about that are that we refer to as the semantic web. I mean, if we think that, and again, I have a question as to whether or not we, our children, we as school, as educators, whether anybody today functioning in a modern global economy can opt out of this, this internet thing, this internet revolution. And it amazes me, literally amazes me, that people don't realize that every keystroke, that every web search, I mean, you know, what is Google? We think of Google, some people would define Google as a technology company. I think Google's well beyond a technology company. I think Google is more closely aligned to a bank than it is to a technology company in terms of what it is. It's a bank of some of our of the most important asset in the world, though, all of our information. And the question is whether you can opt out of that and function. Can you get a job without getting on the internet? Can you maximize your productivity without being on the internet? You know, or do you, you know, can you choose to opt out? Well, only if you buy a cabin in Montana with no electricity and no running water. Everything else is somehow connected or soon to be connected. I mean, you all know that within a matter of a year or two, you're going to be able to go to Walmart, load up your cart, walk out the door, and never pass the checkout line. But as you leave the door, all of that RFID stuff in those packaging, in the packaging in Walmart, which Walmart's required all of their customers and supplies to provide, is automatically going to swipe your debit or credit card, your card of choice with Walmart. And by the way, when you take that item off the shelf and move it into your cart, it automatically signals the supplier in China that another one of those things is needed for that destination. And we're talking about, so when we refer to Web 3.0, we're referring to a semantic web. What is a semantic web? Very simply, it's a web that anticipates your needs, that knows who you are when you walk into the room. Now, if that's a little scary, yeah, it might be. Although there are those like Henry Jenkins and others who argue that it is a very democratic process, actually, democratic with a small d, that in fact places like any corporation that's trying to organize itself around the old central control, command and control model is doomed to failure in an era when everybody has access and when everybody has the freedom of movement across, you know, digital boundaries, if you will, in the internet age. So there's a pessimistic point of view and there's an optimistic point of view. And, you know, the pessimistic point of view is, oh my God, all this information is being rolled up. Well, you know, it's being stated openly. I mean, there was a recent hearing, the deputy counsel for the deputy intelligence chief was testifying before Congress a couple weeks ago. Anybody hear about that one? Basically, he said in Congress, he said the idea of anonymity in this age, with Americans, you know, the U.S. citizens need to have a new understanding of the definition. He didn't say we need to arrive at a new definition. He said we need a new understanding of the definition of privacy. It no longer means being anonymous. The only thing it means is it's a discussion over how much of our personal information can be released by corporations and the government. This to me is amazing. Okay, all right. This is a good sort of discussion juncture for what we mean by an internet, a web that's getting more and more semantic. Now, bear with me for a minute. I'm going to try to connect the dots here. This is a brand new service. Does anybody know what the original what the cost of decoding the original human the genome project, roughly $2.7 billion. Okay? We're 5 years later after the, 6 years later after the decoding of the human genome, and we now can get our personal genome done on our personal 23andMe. Why 23? Because we have, for humans, so we have how many?
23 chromosomes,
right? So 23andMe, that's what it stands for, 23 chromosomes. You can get your personal genome service for $999. You can have your personal genome listed on this. Why would anybody do that? Here's genetics 101. Okay. What are genes, etc.? Let's look at the service. Let's see what we've got. Okay. A gene journal. What do your genes say about you? Ancestry. Who were your ancient ancestors? Through genetic tracing, go back to the original mother of all of us. Now, you know, for some people this causes a little concern, but genome labs, would you like to search your genome? Do you have your mother's sense of taste? What traits do you inherit? I mean, which one of us, if our grandchildren needed to know what our genetic traits were, which one of us wouldn't say, no, you can't have my genome? I mean, which one of us would, you know, want to deny our kids and their kids and their kids this ability to trace specific traits, specific family traits from generation to generation, all for $999. Oh, if you want to, is this like the iPhone? You know, I got one of these things for $600, and sure enough, 4 weeks later, they dropped it to $400. Okay, so if you wait next year, you probably get your personal genome for $500. If the price of the human of your personal genome is dropping at that rate that fast, and that information, and all that is information, billions and billions of bits of information. But think of the implications of that in terms of knowledge and knowledge creation. Think of the implications of all of this information. And I'm just, you know, I mean, that's you know, biology, that's science, that's genetics. How does it relate to education? In my view, it's an excellent indicator of what we're faced with as educators and where we're going in this world where all information, all knowledge being created at an exponential rate in digital formats, where it can be put together. You know, 10 years ago, you couldn't pick a major in college called bioinformatics. It didn't exist. And most of the kids in high school today can tell me what they're going to major in or think they're going to major in, but the truth is that many of their majors don't exist today because they're still evolving at a very rapid rate. So that's the semantic web. That's Web 3.0. And it is here now. I'm going to give you some examples in a minute. Once I get through these dull and boring slides, I'm going to give you some examples of the semantic web. That is the web who not only knows who you are, but knows who your friends are, and what you all like and have in common, and where you all differ, and anticipates your requests before you even make them. Okay? And it exists. Okay, participation is a one-word answer to learning in the 21st century. And if there's a gap today, I would prefer to think of it not as a digital divide between those who have the computer power and those who don't, because the studies are that the thing about this device is not, I don't want to make this sound like it's better than a BlackBerry because it sounds too much like an advertising pitch for Apple. That's not what this is all about. What this is all about is this interface that is now coming out on all of the cell phones. The fact that it connects to the internet regardless of the network restrictions that I have in this building, that I can get to Google, any website, I have unrestricted access. Go to a high school administrator today and ask them if it's okay if you open up all of the computer hardware in the school to unrestricted access to the internet. And you'll see somebody's face turn ashen pretty quickly. Okay? Because of the risks involved. But this device doesn't. And this fits in your pocket, this will go everywhere. It takes podcasts, it takes TV shows, it takes video, it does all of those kinds of things. The point is that I worry not so much about a digital divide, the $100 laptop, the OLPC project at MIT, which is coming online. There's a whole question, should we put laptops in the hands of every kid in school? Well, you know, no, what do we have them do when they have a laptop? I mean, laptops, you know, if we all had laptops here, wouldn't be a bad idea, but if we did, I know you'd all be looking at the sports pages or, you know, something else rather than listening to me. It'd be annoying because I wouldn't see your faces. All that goes away because these devices are no longer intrusive and no longer obtrusive to our have engaging in a dialogue. These should enable it. And so it's about participation. Where I worry is not so much in a digital divide, because these devices are getting cheaper all of the time. In our urban schools, you know, students may not have internet access at home. Most of them have a cell phone. And most of their cell phones will soon be internet enabled, if they're not already, with instant messaging and global positioning systems and all that kind of stuff, video downloads, etc., as part of their base service. Okay? And the G phone, which is coming out, is surely to drop prices even another order of magnitude. So I'm not worried anymore about digital divide, who has access to the technology and who doesn't. I am worried about a participation gap. Who is actually participating in a meaningful way with this collaboration and this information? And what is the role of us as educators in ensuring that we close the participation gap? So that's one thing I'm concerned about. This notion of social production. Yochai Benkler from Yale Law School wrote a book called The Wealth of Networks. It was clearly aimed at arguing a new era of economics, much in the same way as Smith argued in Wealth of Nations, that he was defining the laws of economics. And Benkler, under his Wealth of Networks, has laid out a vision for a future based on abundance, not scarcity. That no longer will our economics in the world relate to the scarcity of natural resources, for example. I mean, yeah, we're going to run out of oil. But if we can harness the power of the sun, we have an unlimited form of energy. It's just hard to get the oil companies to do that because it's sort of, you know, cutting your own throat. But that there are unlimited sources of energy that are clean and renewable. We just haven't gotten to the point yet where giving up the economics of scarcity has made sense to those players in the economic arena who have made their fortune, if you will, on the economics of scarcity. But Benkler argues that social production, open systems, open, you know, creative commons, etc., redefines economics, networks redefine economics in ways that we no longer argue about the economics of scarcity, it's the economics of abundance, and the only differentiator is the value you add based on the significance of your product rather than the material or the cost of your product. In other words, there's no competitive, I'm an educator, I'm allowed to digress, I'm digressing, but there's no discernible comparative advantage in cost of manufacture or cost of production, and I'm talking about creative production, the creative production of whether it's textbooks or whether it's art or even, you know, we could even go into the sports metaphor. There's no comparative advantage anymore in terms of brute force, you know, production power. It all resides at the ends where it's creative or it's interpersonal skills. Those are the areas where value or significance is created. And those are the things that we should be working on. And social production is just another way of saying that the we is always going to be smarter and trump the I in a complex problem-solving effort. So it's about community-generated content as opposed to individual-created content. So learning ends up being a social experience. I've got some good examples. Again, this isn't interactive, so I can go here later. But I like to use this example. This is a wiki called The Mysterious Flame of Queen Loanna. If you Google it, it's an annotation project. It's a college-level project, but it's a wiki. And going to assume you know what a wiki is, but if you don't, very quickly, a wiki is simply a place where you can go and work on any content collaboratively, and I can show you lots of examples of that that I think are even more instructive than this one. But very basically, this is where students get together and as work on annotating a novel a classic novel where they annotate in great depth. In other words, they're able to get in and address things in a great depth. Howard Gardner has come out with a new book called Five Minds for the Future. And the subject of rigor, which we're all concerned about, what Howard Gardner talks about is, I'll just quickly give you a couple of his bullet points. One of the things he talks about as an important five mind for the future, one of the minds he talks about is a disciplined mind. And what does he mean by a disciplined mind? Well, very frank, he sums it up by saying, the ability to identify truly important topics or concepts within the discipline. Second, spend a significant amount of time on that topic. This is how to create a disciplined mind. Approach the topic in a number of ways, okay, different perspective. And most important is set up a performance of understanding. Performance of understanding. Now, I think those are four things that we try to do in our programs with our kids at the Center for 21st Century Skills with our high school students. Is, you know, those are what I would call the rigor of our activity, and it ends up with a performance, a student performance that demonstrates competency and capability in these areas. I'm just going to show you some images of this place where it's open source architecture that's being studied in a place called Second Life. I don't know how many of you have heard of Second Life. Second Life? Anybody? Okay. Second Life is a virtual world, a 3D world. Again, this is an area that there's a lot of research being done. Places like the Center for Comparative Media Studies at MIT and elsewhere are looking, media labs, looking at ways to use these virtual worlds, these sims, if you will, these simulated worlds to enhance learning and the social aspects of it. So what I want you to note about this one is that this is an attempt to bring a social element to this virtual world. These students, if you will, sitting in these chairs, are having could virtually have a conversation, could virtually have a voice conversation as if it was in real life. Their avatars mimic motions, gestures, etc. So there's a realistic feel to it. There's a sense that you're actually participating in a way that you wouldn't in a simple instant message exchange or in a video conference exchange that's more one-way exchange of information. So I wanted to give you a sense of the way these communities are coming together in a very social way. I did load this Google Earth. How many of you are familiar with Google Earth? Okay. I've just zoomed in on Manhattan here. Again, just on the theme of, you know, how things are changing. In other words, when we talk about faith, about how things work, how many of us really know how this works, all this Google Earth and search engines, et cetera? And in a lot of educational settings, I'll ask the audience, here you've got an image of New York City, and I can zoom in literally to the street level. In fact, that there was a controversy that some folks didn't like the photo, the picture of them at the street level because they were doing something embarrassing. I don't know, picking their nose or something like that. But literally, there was some objections to people were always going. There were a number of people who were always going to object to that level of intimacy with our daily lives. But my question is this: Google is arguably the most successful company of the 21st century so far. Right? how does Google get all this, you know, how does Google, as successful as it is, how does Google get all this information? All of these street level shots, you know, photographs in New York City and towns across the country, in places around the world, how does Google get all this information? Do they have thousands of people walking the streets of New York, taking pictures, writing down where all the cafes are, writing down where the museums are, the taxi cab stands, you name it, all of this information is there. The Starbucks cafes, are they sending an army of people out to gather all this information? Uh-uh. How are they getting all this information? They did something that is unheard of in the history of business. They took their most important asset, which is their database, and gave access to everyone who asked, regardless of qualification, to their database through an open API or application programming interface. Okay? They gave access to their most important asset, the keys to the kingdom. And they said to anyone, without regard to qualification or background checks or anything, hack it. Go in and put your information in. Here are the keys. You drive. We trust you. What a novel concept. We trust you. Okay? And indeed, all that information is being put into Google by our students for the most part, or at least people under 30, by our students and by people who are digital natives. So this tremendous richness of information is all being community generated. This is, again, social production. That Bankler talks about, that's turning our economics into an economics of abundance and not an economics of scarcity. Reason. But if you go to this Gandhi chimpanzee blog, it will take you to a it'll take you to a blog site. But instead of the words that you typically get in a blog, instead of somebody posting a written blog, there is an icon you click on. And it takes you via Google Earth directly to the Gombe, chimpanzee or the Gombe wildlife refuge in Kenya on the shores of Lake Tanzania. It takes you directly there and right down to the level, and then you, and for students, this is extremely engaging. They can actually blog and post and question and get responses from a researcher on the ground about what's happening in that particular area, learning about, doing the sort of natural history or natural science study of gorillas and chimpanzees in their natural habitat. It's an indicator of things to come.
Do I need to say you can borrow his guitar.
Funny.
Isn't that so great?
That's really great.
Yeah.
You can get it to.
Thanks, Melvin. That's really sweet of you. I really appreciate that. It's always been my dream to run on stage and give Dylan the guitar. If something's messing up.
Right.
It's like, the roadies forgot your guitar, Bob, but I've got one.
Actually, something that did happen once where I forgot my
guitar. Okay, this is, I'm gonna cut this off short here, but this is Suzanne Vega, who decided to put one of her concerts online, and on a circuit, if you will, to talk about her upcoming concert in Second Life. So there's an interviewer there. And she's playing for an audience, and the audience showed up at this event. You can go to Second Life, and you can look at a listing of events, and you can go to any number of events. Well, okay, this happens to be a concert. What else is on Second Life? Okay, I'm going to show you some other examples of that. But this is kind of interesting because, again, creating an avatar in Second Life, Suzanne Vega, doesn't look identical to her. I suppose I might figure her out. But, you create your own avatar. And it's interesting to see, by the way, how kids create their avatars when they're in Second Life. When I say kids, I mean older kids, college-age kids. Second Life mirrors real life. And so there are certainly some risks in doing Second Life at the high school or below level. But what is that new game out that kids, that little kids are doing? They're making their avatars work, and they're collecting more avatars. Anybody familiar with it? No? Okay. was interesting. Before coming up here, I was at a restaurant. I was at a Panera Bread, working on my computer, actually. No life. Anyways, I was working on my computer. A little girl sitting next to me and her mother, she was watching the fact that I was working in Second Life. And she talked to her mother about the fact that she's got this little thing where she's collected. She's 4 years old. She's already collected two of these Pritkins or whatever they
are. Oh, right.
Webkins. Thank you. So, and I use that as an example of saying how ready these kids are coming for this kind of virtual world, social activity or interaction. Okay, so you saw Suzanne Vega. This is a little video clip of making her guitar in Second Life. Skill, but these are all manipulatives that are built into the Second Life toolkit. Quite frankly, there's a lot of skill here that shows mastery of a number of concepts, not just making three-dimensional objects, but structure the sound box, getting the proportions right. Yeah, this is very quick. This is a time-lapse photography, so with measurements, geometric precision. Okay, I think you may get the picture. Again, what I was going to do, and I didn't download it on this computer, was show you in something called SketchUp, which is a free Google download. It's an ability to create objects, three-dimensional objects, landscapes, etc. in very powerful ways. I'm going to give you a quick example of that, and then we'll move on to another area of the conversation.
Starry, starry night. Paint your
palette blue and red. Yeah, this is time-lapse photography. By the way, when you work in Second Life, you have a button you can use to record everything you do.
With eyes that know
the darkness. So in other words, you can record a movie of making these kinds of terrestrial landscapes.
Sketch the trees and the daffodils. Catch the breeze and the winter chill. In colors on the snowy linen land. Now I understand what you tried to say to me, how you suffered for your sanity, how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they did not know. Perhaps they'll listen now. Starry, starry night. Flaming flowers that brightly blaze. Swirling clouds in violet haze.
As you watch this, think about the math, the geometries, the design,
colors,
the creativity that goes into making this.
Morning fields of amber grain, weathered faces lined in pain, are soothed beneath the artist's loving hand. Now I understand what you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they did not know how. Perhaps they'll listen now, for they could not love you. But still your love was true. And when no hope was left in sight on that starry, starry night. You took your life as lovers often do. But I could have told you, Vincent, this world was never meant for one as beautiful as you. Starry, starry night.
Okay, again, that's pretty interesting video to watch, satisfying on a number of levels. But it, from an instructive point of perspective, it shows that anything is possible in this virtual world environment. I'm going to give you a very specific example. I'm going to tell you how this kind of ties into what we do, because the question is can any of this be done now? That's a legitimate question. Can any of this be done now? The Connecticut High School Innovation Exposition is the culmination of a year-long program, a year-long project that students are in working. We have 350 students across Connecticut that are in from 30 different school districts that are in our Innovation Academy program. And what they're asked to do they're asked to create a game that teaches a concept in science, technology, or engineering, or math for middle school students. So we give them gaming technology. We're actually using technology developed at MIT called Scratch, which is not a, it's a programming language that is for non-programmers, the best way to describe it. And it's a little bit like Lego bricks. You click things together, and it makes their sprites or their characters. That's the word they use in Scratch for characters, is sprites. It makes the sprites do certain things, but it's more than that, because you've got, just as you saw in that video back there, you've got to design the landscape, you've got to design the backdrop. It's very much like putting on a school play. It takes a year to do. So the students start in September, October, and they work through the year. Now this year we happen to have 100 Chinese students from northwestern China, a place in China that very few Westerners actually go to. It's out in the Gobi Desert. I'll show you pictures of camels and sand dunes with chairlifts on them and that kind of thing. Very interesting place, but we got 100 students from that part of the world that are working with our students, collaborating with our students. We're going to have 20 students from Hartford, from an inner city school in Hartford, in March, go over to China and work for a couple of weeks with those students at that university in northwest China. We're going to help them, we're going to mentor them in preparing for this exposition. And then at the exposition, we're going to have a Second Life virtual exposition running side by side with the real exposition. So the real exposition will have students who will set up trade show booths, show their games, discuss it with business and community leaders, political leaders, educational leaders will come in to see this at the Connecticut Convention Center in Hartford. We expect about 2,000 people there. The students will show their projects. At the same time, on a large flat panel screen on the wall, the Chinese students will be doing in Second Life their virtual exposition from Yinchuan in China. Okay, and so that's how we plan to integrate both gaming technology and this virtual world environment. But what you just saw in that last video, Don McLean singing, I think, pretty indicative of what we're trying to get these kids to do, is to use their imaginations, to be creative, to create these virtual worlds, and to make meaning out of the information and the tools that they're given to. And this is cross-disciplinary thinking. This is critical thinking. Across disciplines, because we've got as many females in this program as males. We've got as many urban students as suburban students. You know, out of 450 kids, we've got an equal balance of both, and we've got roles for all of them to play. They're required to form teams, to collaborate. It's project-based learning. And the biggest challenge is to retrain the teaching core, our teachers, our 40 teachers that are working with us on this, to retrain them to step back from the process, to avoid being, to following the old model of received knowledge, received authority, and to go with the idea that it's student-centered learning, it's constructivist pedagogy, And that this digital technology enables all of that at a level that we've never been able to actuate before. So that's the opportunity, that's the challenge. What I submit is that this digital age is really beginning to reshape and recast our thinking about, you know, how learning occurs in an age, what knowledge really means in an age of, in the digital age, you know, the redefinition of knowledge. I don't know, for me it's been interesting to see this evolution happen so quickly, and I wonder about our ability as institutions, as a society, to adapt to some of these changes. The problem in the global economy, in the digital economy, is folks are skipping a generation of infrastructure or two. They are growing at a tremendous rate. They're creating wealth at a tremendous rate. They are the competition of our students in the world to come. It's really a question of how we all survive and thrive in a planet that we tend to think of as having limited resources. But the knowledge resources coming out of places like China, India, Eastern Europe, what Tom Friedman calls the the world is flat, these new players on the field, these new folks that have just come into the 21st century as if they materialized from nowhere, and how we assimilate all of that and again use the power of our current institutions. And oh, by the way, most of these kids, their goal is to come to the U.S. For their higher ed. Says something. Somebody once said that America has the best education system in the world. It's too bad you have to wait to college to get it. It's an interesting thing. So let me do this. Let me finish up. Let me close with a whisper and take any questions that you have.